The History of Poland, Episode 12, Imperial Chaos, or The Investiture Controversy. Hello, and welcome back. As we discussed last time, Bolesław II has taken the throne. He spent his time intervening in the affairs of other nations, most notably Hungary, Bohemia, and the Kievan Rus, and has seemingly managed to put Poland back on track to being a stable state. Well, this week, we're going to return to Bolesław's life, and specifically the impact that he had on the Holy Roman Empire and his relationship with the papacy. Yes, as the name of this episode indicates, today we're going to be talking at length about the role of the emperor and his relationship with the pope, things like excommunication, penance, and a bunch of other fascinating topics. To begin with, let's start by taking a look at what's been happening in the papacy for the last 100 years. We're going to simplify things quite a bit, since this is the History of Poland and not a History of the Church podcast, so forgive me if I brush over some nuance. As we've talked about in previous episodes, the Latin Christian Church was centered in Rome, with the Pope in Rome being the chief spiritual authority of the Church. Before you start to think, yeah, I know all about that, you can skip this, let me just say that what we know as the Roman Catholic Church has taken a number of forms over the year. While the fundamental doctrines at the root of this branch of Christianity have remained mostly consistent over time, with subtle changes over the centuries, the actual authority, institutions, and power of the Church has waxed and waned. That is where the big differences are. Some of the more major changes came during a period of concentrated reform during the reign of Pope Leo IX, who was pope from 1049 to 1054. While only a few years, Leo took a number of incredibly significant steps to reform the Church. Two of the most notable reforms included his decision to bar members of the clergy from marrying and to make it clear that simony, or the act of buying and selling church offices, was clearly off limits. While his reforms may seem minor, they had a profound impact on the life of one monk who joined Leo on his way to be elected as pope in Rome. This monk's name was Hildebrand. This man, who joined the upper echelons of ecclesiastical power in Rome and worked closely with Leo and subsequent popes as they tried to reform the church, would eventually become known as Pope Gregory VII. Hildebrand, who I'll refer to as both Gregory and Hildebrand depending on the context, was born around 1015 in central Italy. There's not a lot we know about his early life, but we do know that by the time he seemed to be a teenager, he was on his path towards a clerical career, studying in Rome under a number of influential teachers. Notable among these teachers was another man who would later become pope. This man isn't especially important to our story, except that when he was deposed and exiled by the Holy Roman Emperor Henry III, he took Hildebrand with him into exile in Germany. We don't know for sure, but this deposition and exile may have been formative in Hildebrand's later opinions about the Holy Roman Empire, the emperor, and what spiritual authority the emperor did and didn't have. But that's just speculation. Hildebrand continued to rise through the papal ranks over the following decades and seemed to have primarily split his time between Germany and Italy. Now, without getting into too much detail, let's just say that there wasn't a lot of papal stability during Hildebrand's life. From the time of Leo becoming pope to the time that Hildebrand was elected, there were five popes, with an average tenure of about 4 years. In addition, there were a number of anti-popes, who were essentially rival popes that were recognized by a separate group of people, whether secular or spiritual, which complicated things further. It's interesting to think about Hildebrand's development during this time, even though we don't have a ton of detail. You see, as he rose through the ranks, he in many ways became a center of power in the papacy. From this vantage point, it's likely that he grew increasingly aware that the papacy needed to be reformed in order to ensure stability and spiritual independence. Finally, in 1073, after decades of Hildebrand increasing his own power in the shadows of other popes, Pope Alexander II died, leaving the position of pope without a holder. Hildebrand appears to have been in Rome during this time, in his role as a senior clergy official, and was there at the funeral service for Alexander at the Lateran Basilica. It was during this funeral service that the crowds pressed in on Hildebrand and began to shout that they wanted him to become the next pope. It may have been a spontaneous decision of the crowd, as some records indicate, but it may also have been that Hildebrand or a supporter of his planted some people in the crowd that began to shout out that they wanted him to be pope. Either way, upon hearing the cries of, "Let Hildebrand be pope," Hildebrand promptly fled the area, not wanting to be seen as a usurper or illegally being elected pope. But that doesn't mean he didn't want to be elected, it just seems he wanted it to happen in the right way. So, Hildebrand headed over to where other church leaders had gathered and was legally elected as pope. Despite the unusual circumstances of his election as pontiff, including the acclamation of the people, the fact that Hildebrand doesn't technically appear to be eligible for the office as he's not even an ordained priest at this point, the election happening earlier than it was supposed to according to papal law, and the fact that the people of Rome pushed for him before the cardinals had even gathered to choose someone, Hildebrand was now the chief spiritual authority of the Latin Christian Church. Who cares about irregularities? Well, some people do, but we'll find out about them later. Hildebrand would henceforth be known as Pope Gregory VII. Pope Gregory was not a man to just sit idly and wonder what's going to happen to him during his tenure as pope. Instead, picking up the torch from his predecessors, Gregory decided that further church reform was needed. Which brings us to the primary controversy of the time, the chief pillar of the antagonism between the pope and the emperor, and the test of the fortitude of the institutions of the church and the empire. Now, before we get into this controversy, let's take a moment and check in with the empire. Let's see how it's doing. Well, the current emperor is Henry IV. Henry became king of Germany as a young child and saw his empire ruled by a regency until he came of age. It was during this regency that the German kingdom was in a fair amount of turmoil. Henry couldn't exercise his rights as ruler, what with being a child, yet with his mother as regent and a number of factions all vying for influence over the child king, there was continuous angst about the future of the state. It was during this period that nobles in the area of Saxony began to grow uncomfortable with being under the yoke of imperial power. They had experienced a relative amount of freedom under the regency of Henry's mother, but once Henry began to rule in his own right, he naturally wanted to enforce his will upon his subjects. Well, according to the records we have, part of Henry's will was to tax the resources of the area, build castles, and generally to take a bunch of steps that caused the Saxon nobles to suddenly notice the burden that was being placed upon them. As a result, there was continuous grumbling from the Saxon nobles during these years, and from the middle to the end of 1073, there was high tension between the Saxons and Henry. It wasn't yet open conflict, but there was some grumblings about the need to take action, and even an armed standoff that resulted in both sides viewing the other with increased suspicion. So, things in the empire aren't going especially well. Henry's position as ruler is far from firm, and he's having to face down rebellious elements of his subjects. Fortunately, he's still the emperor of the Holy Roman Empire, so he's got lots of other perks. One of those perks is that, from the empire's perspective, the emperor is the individual who invests individuals with authority when they become bishops, archbishops, abbots, etc. This is partially so that the empire has a firm hold over the religious direction of the state, but also because many of these positions entitled the office holders to great land holdings, material power, wealth, and in some cases control over local armed forces. These were positions of great influence, which is why, of course, the emperor was so keen on choosing who occupied the positions. He wanted people loyal to him. Well, sadly, for the emperor at least, the pope isn't especially keen on the emperor retaining this perk of office. You see, from Pope Gregory's viewpoint, the emperor is the servant of the church, not the other way around. As such, the pope should be the one appointing religious officials, not the emperor. Of course, Henry disagreed. This tension over who is in charge of the church, what the chain of command is, and who invests individuals with ecclesiastical authority is all a part of what historians call the Investiture Controversy. To underline his perspective on this, Pope Gregory decides to follow up on earlier reforms that tried to centralize investiture authority and issues a decree. The decree is recorded for us, and because it's not that long, I will now quote it in full. Quote, "Inasmuch as we have learned that, contrary to the establishments of the Holy Fathers, the investiture with churches is, in many places, performed by laypersons, and that from this case many disturbances arise in the church by which the Christian religion is trodden underfoot, we decree that no one of the clergy shall receive the investiture with a bishopric or abbey or church from the hand of an emperor or king or of any layperson, male or female, but if he shall presume to do so, he shall clearly know that such investiture is bereft of apostolic authority, and that he himself shall lie under excommunication until fitting satisfaction shall have been rendered." End quote. In other words, the emperor can't appoint church officials, and that if he tries, he's going to be excommunicated. If you're excommunicated, there are a number of penalties that can be applied, including having your contracts voided, losing your standing before judges, not being able to participate in religious activities, and generally becoming an outcast of official society. Oh, and if you're an overlord of somebody, they don't have to recognize you as their overlord anymore. That's fun. It's not irreversible, but it's not a great mark to have on your resume, especially if you're the emperor. Well, unfortunately, this decree, which was issued in 1073, seems to have conflicted with a decision by Emperor Henry to appoint a man become Archbishop of Milan. This decision had originally been made in 1070, 3 years before Gregory had even become pope, so it may have originally passed under the radar. But then, after a few more misunderstandings, and a period of continued tension between the pope and the emperor over who was really the big boss of Europe, Henry decided to not only reaffirm his appointment of a new Archbishop of Milan, overriding Gregory's own appointment to that same position, but also to appoint some men to a handful of other positions in Italy. Not only was he appointing clergy, but he was doing it in the literal backyard of the Pope. This ain't gonna go so well. Notably, this happened in the year 1075, shortly after Henry won the Battle of Langensalza against some Saxon rebels. It may have been because of his strengthened position after the victory that he decided to push the issue of investiture, or it may have been that he just finally had the attention span to work on muscling the church. Whatever his reasons, he decided to push back against the Pope. The Pope was not thrilled with this. So, in December of 1075, Gregory sent a letter to Henry, which is full of harsh words and warnings. My favorite part, which sets the tone for the whole letter, are the opening lines. Quote, Bishop Gregory, servant of the servants of God, to King Henry, greeting and apostolic benediction. That is, if he be obedient to the apostolic chair, as beseems a Christian king. Considering and carefully weighing with what strict judgment we shall have to render account for the ministry entrusted to us by St. Peter, chief of the apostles, it is with hesitation that we have sent unto thee the apostolic benediction. End quote. The Pope continues with this letter, explaining that he's making some mistakes as emperor. He's hanging out with people who have been excommunicated, he's been trying to create bishops and archbishops in place of the Pope, and in general he's been acting up. He then goes on to say that if Henry repents, shows himself to be a true son and defender of the church, and if he confesses to a true bishop, then he'll be forgiven. So, the letter is sent, and Gregory is probably sitting there thinking, he'll probably rectify the situation and all will be well. That's not at all what happened. Instead, the emperor, his bishops, loyal nobles and princes, and his attendants all gathered together at what's called the Synod of Worms. Synod meaning an assembly of clergy, and Worms being the name of the place the assembly was meeting in. Anyway, they all met up there, and apparently the emperor was not going to toe the line. Instead, seeing as he's been constantly challenged by just about everyone, and there are plenty of people who want to see him knocked down a rung, the emperor decides to stand up to the pope. His loyal bishops agree to support this move, and two letters are sent in January of 1076, one from the bishops and one from Henry. This is what the bishops had to say to Gregory. Quote, Since, therefore, your accession has been inaugurated by such perjuries, since, through the abuse of your innovations, the Church of God is in danger through so severe a storm, and since you have defiled your life and conversation with such manifold infamy, we renounce the obedience which we never promised to you, nor shall we in future at all observe it. And since, as you have publicly proclaimed, not one of us has been to you so far a bishop, so also shall you henceforth be pope for none of us. End quote. Essentially, the bishops are denouncing Gregory as pope and saying they don't owe him any loyalty. In other words, these bishops are probably not going to be invited over for dinner. Henry's letter is equally scornful. He starts by saying, quote, Henry, king not through usurpation, but through the holy ordination of God, to Hildebrand, at present, not pope, but false monk, end quote. Henry then goes on to decry Gregory's papacy, accusing him of a number of crimes, and finally telling him that he should descend from his place and let another become pope. He also says some things I'm not going to repeat since this is a family podcast, but he does have some choice words for the Pope. The Pope gets this letter and decides in mid-February of 1076 that he is going to depose Henry and excommunicate him. He says, in the form of a prayer, quote, I withdraw through your being God, power and authority from Henry the King, son of Henry the Emperor, who has risen against your church with unheard of insolence, the rule over the whole kingdom of the Germans and over Italy, and I absolve all Christians from the bonds of the oath which they have made or shall make to him, and I forbid anyone to serve him as king. End quote. This is problematic. You see, Henry is in a precarious political position, and if none of his nobles are bound by the church to honor their oaths to him, then they're likely to rebel and try to stake their own claims to independence in the world. Including, notably, the Saxon rebels he's been dealing with. Saxon rebels who happen to be allied with Bolesław II of Poland. So, in 1077, in January, after a year of fraught tensions, Henry decides to go out of his way to meet with the Pope in a place called Canossa. He comes in humble clothing, essentially begging the Pope to forgive him. This act of penance wins over the Pope. The proposed sentences of deposition and excommunication are lifted, and the two are friends again. They then go on their merry way, doing the best for their people and trying to keep the peace. No, I'm just kidding. Instead, while they are on speaking terms for a little while, the Saxons are really enjoying their independence and decide they're going to elect a new emperor. The Pope likes this idea and then deposes Henry again, to which Henry then deposes the Pope and chooses a new Pope, which is known as creating an anti-Pope. And now there are two Popes and two emperors. Yay! Anyway, we do need to get back to Poland, and this controversy is going to go on for decades and decades, and I don't want to drag us through all the gritty details, so here's an incredibly quick overview about what's going to happen. Henry invades Italy, the whole anti-Pope and anti-Emperor thing doesn't really work out for anyone, and eventually Gregory dies. Henry also dies, but his descendants and future popes reconcile, ending the controversy. There's a lot that happens, I'm sure we'll touch on it in future episodes, and, you know, maybe even I'll do it in a spin-off series. We'll see. You may be thinking, why did you just spend so long talking about this investiture thing? What does Poland have to do with any of this? Why am I subscribed to this podcast? These are all excellent questions. The reason I bring this up is that Bolesław II is a fierce opponent of Henry throughout all of this. He sides with the Saxons, sending them troops and support in hopes of overthrowing Henry. He denounces Henry, and importantly, he becomes pen pals and friends with Pope Gregory. He also begins to implement many of the Gregorian reforms that the Pope had been pushing in the churches in Poland, making it clear that he and his nation are friends of Rome. Gregory decides he's a fan of this Duke of Poland fellow, and in an act that is as much an act of friendship from Rome to Poland as it is an act of annoying Henry, Gregory sends a crown to Bolesław, allowing him to become king. Bolesław is dutifully coronated in Poland on Christmas Day in 1076, making a clear claim that he does not owe any allegiance to Henry. This is quite important for two reasons. The first is that this is going to be the last coronation of a king of Poland for over 200 years. Yes, spoiler alert, we're not about to enter into some great era of Polish stability, monarchy, authority, peace, etc. Instead, this is the last hurrah of the first generation of PS monarchs. The second reason is that this is the only glimmer we have of Bolesław being on good terms with the church. As we'll find out next week, Bolesław ends his life on very, very bad terms with the Roman church. Which wouldn't really make that much sense to you unless I pointed out how big of a deal it was that he befriended the Pope during the investiture controversy. But we'll stop for now, and we'll get to that next time. As always, feel free to find out more about this week's episode on our Patreon page at patreon.com/historyofpolandpodcast. You can even support us there and help, you know, support the creation of spin-off series. I love getting emails from everyone at historyofpolandpodcast@gmail.com, and if you'd like to join the people who have already generously done so, you should feel free to leave a review on iTunes. I'll see you next time.